Good morning and welcome. Welcome as we join together here in the sanctuary and at home to worship God. It's good to see everyone here, especially if this is your first time with us or your first time in a while. Please do stay if you can. Everyone is welcome to stay for team coffee over here after service and continue fellowship together. Tomorrow we continue our walks around the parish with another litter pick. We meet in the St. Mungo Hall for tea and coffee from 6 o'clock or 6:45 if you simply want to do the walk. Just bring yourself, litter grabbers will be provided. We had about a dozen last week, so that was a good start. Our summer group meets again this Thursday for anyone who'd like to come along for a cup of tea, biscuit and a chance to chat. There's also the opportunity to have a go at things like craft making and carpet bowls. And it was great to see folk last Thursday prepared to have a go at the bowls. And there's also fun activities for every age, but everything is optional. So please pass the word around, make a date in your diary. Thursday afternoons, 1:30 to 3:30. You don't have to take part in anything you don't want to, and you can also come and go as you please. There's a coffee morning and sale bake being held by our neighbours at St. Oswald's next door this Saturday, the 3rd of August, from 10:30 to 12:30 in aid of the RNLI station at Tobermory. And there should be a poster up, and if it isn't, I will find it and put it up in the vestibule. There's going to be home baking, children's crafts, and a new-to-you stall. Home baking will be gratefully received, so please do come along and support our neighbours at St. Oswald's if you can. Donnie Robertson's funeral is this Tuesday, the 30th of July, 2 o'clock at South Lanarkshire Crematorium. That's this Tuesday, 2 o'clock at South Lanarkshire Crematorium. And our thoughts and prayers continue to be with Donnie's family and friends at this time. And finally, if you're able, we're looking to move the chairs from around the church onto the carpet so that the floors can be given a good mop down. Obviously, we'll leave that until after folk have had your tea. You won't have to stand for tea. But first of all, the hymn books and Bibles need to be moved from under the seats, and we'll put tables down, and that might be easier for some folk, and then once they're moved, the chairs will be moved. Many hands make light work, so they say, and last time we did it, it was done quicker than we thought possible. So please, if you can, give us a hand with that after the service. Thank you.
Thank you, John, for this morning's intimations. Good morning, everyone. Good morning. And in case you were wondering what that strange thing was outside, that was the sun. We've not seen it very often this year. Let's still ourselves as we come into God's presence this morning. The Lord our God overflows with loving kindness and is close to all who call on his name. We praise and bless God's holy name forever. The Lord our God is glorious beyond our imagination, yet he hears every cry we make. We praise and bless God's holy name forever. The Lord our God is worthy to be praised and honoured by every generation, by people of every age. So we come this morning to worship and praise God's holy name. And we worship God together as we sing our first hymn this morning, 187, There's a Wideness in God's Mercy.
Thank you.
Let us worship God in prayer. Let's pray. Generous God, we come before you at this time in expectation, waiting to receive from your abundance, so that we may share what you give to us with others. This morning we come longing to be filled, to eat of the bread of life, to drink from your life-giving streams, to taste your goodness and experience abundant life. And when we come before you, seeking you, you are always there to receive us and satisfy our hunger and thirst. For you alone are God, the source and sustainer of life. Yet despite receiving all we need from you and more, we acknowledge that there are times when our own wants and wishes have filled the horizon to the exclusion of all else and blinkered us to the needs and concerns of others. When the fear that sharing what we have may lead to our own impoverishment and has led us to be silent and still instead of speaking out in support of the vulnerable, Lord, we ask for your forgiveness. Merciful God, we know that even when we do let you down, you are always gracious and merciful, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love. You are always good to all, and your compassion covers all that you have made. You are always faithful in all your words and gracious to us in all your deeds. You are the one who upholds all who are falling and raises up all who are bowed down. And to all of us, no matter when or where we have got things wrong, we have complete reassurance in the words Jesus spoke over each one of us. Your sins are forgiven. And we remember not only those words that Jesus spoke over us, but the prayer that he taught us to say together. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come. Your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Do you ever feel a little overwhelmed when you see or hear the number of people in need across the world? We hear on the news or we read in the newspapers millions of people in other countries who they don't have clean water to drink. They don't have access to medicines when they need them most. Or we may hear that thousands of people in our own city don't have enough to eat and are having to use food banks more and more. Or we may hear that more people in our parish are isolated because maybe family have moved away and they feel lonely. Whenever we hear things like this, we might think to ourselves, well, what can I do? What difference can I make? I haven't got very much to offer. I can't change that situation. I wonder if Jesus' disciples thought that when they were faced with a crowd of over 5,000 hungry people one day. And Jesus asked them, come on lads, where are we going to buy the bread to feed all these people? They've been following me for hours and they've been listening to my teaching. Well, they maybe all looked at the ground and shuffled their feet a little bit, looked at one another thinking, what do we say? Then Philip answered, but Jesus, it would take more than half a year's wages to buy enough bread so everyone could just get a bite. The disciples knew that they couldn't feed over 5,000 people because they didn't have much to offer. In fact, they didn't have anything to offer themselves, and they couldn't change that situation. But one little boy had 5 small loaves of bread and 2 little fish. And he gave those to Jesus. The little boy simply gave Jesus all that he had, and it was maybe his lunch. So maybe he was a wee bit unsure if he was going to give that to Jesus, but he did. Jesus then went on to feed everyone with bread and fish, and everyone had enough to eat, and the Bible tells us that there were actually 12 baskets of food left over. Because once Jesus had given thanks to the little boy's offering and gave over to God, the impossible happened. In fact, Paul writes in Ephesians, God can do anything, far more than you could ever understand or imagine. Nothing is impossible to God. And since that day, many people who have followed Jesus have discovered that when they give what they can to Jesus, Jesus and God can turn it into far, far more, way beyond what they could ever have imagined. We all give what we can to God. Some of us can give our finances, and what might seem a little to us can make the difference between a village getting a new well for clean water, or a donation to a local food bank so another family can have something to eat. We all have time that we can offer, time that we can speak to God, we can talk to Him in prayer. Some of you have maybe heard the story of the two Christian sisters, Peggy and Christine Smith, who lived on Lewis. And they were really concerned about not only the state of their town, but this church as well. They were really quite concerned that not many people were going along to the church. Now, at this point, they were 84 and 82 respectively. Peggy was blind and Christine couldn't walk. So they did the only thing they could. They prayed. They agreed to pray twice a week for as long as it took to see their community changed. And not long after that, an amazing revival broke out on Lewis where hundreds and hundreds of people gave their lives to Jesus. So why not give 10 minutes a day to pray? Pray while you're walking to the shops. Pray while you're driving, but please don't close your eyes. Pray when you're walking the dogs, or just when you're in the house having a wee cup of tea or a cup of coffee. Because in giving our time to Jesus through prayer, amazing things can happen. Some of us have the energy that we can help other people. Practically, we can do that in a whole number of ways. And in doing that, Jesus can use us to change somebody else's life. So let's be encouraged by that little boy who gave what he had. It didn't seem a lot in the grand scheme of things at all. But when he offered it to Jesus, and Jesus blessed it, it multiplied beyond anyone's imagination. Whether it's our time, our energy, our money, our resources, our talents, our prayer time, let's trust that in Jesus' hands what we offer can be used in wonderful ways to bless others. Amen. We're going to hear the story of the feeding of the 5,000, so our next hymn brings that into a wonderful perspective as we sing together, Two Little Fishes, Five Loaves of Bread.
Thank you. Our first reading today can be found in the second book of Kings, chapter 4, reading from verse 42 to 44. Let us hear the word of God. Another time, a man came from Baal Shalisha, bringing Elisha's 20 loaves of bread made from the first barley harvested that year, and some freshly cut ears of corn. Elisha told his servant to feed the group of prophets with this, but he answered, "Do you think this is enough for 100 men?" Elisha replied, "Give it to them to eat, because the Lord says that they will eat and still have some left." So the servant set the food before them, and as the Lord had said, they all ate, and there were still some left over.
Thank you, Nora, for the first reading this morning. We sing together, "Praise the One Who Breaks the Darkness."
Because he had seen his miracles of healing those who were ill. Jesus went up a hill and sat down with his disciples. The time for the Passover festival was near. Jesus looked round and saw that a large crowd was coming to him. So he asked Philip, "Where can we buy enough food to feed all these people?" He said this to test Philip. Actually, he knew what he already would do. Philip answered, For everyone to have even a little, it would take more than 200 silver coins to buy enough bread. Another of his disciples, Andrew, who was Simon Peter's brother, said, There is a boy here who has 5 loaves of barley bread and 2 fish, but they will certainly not be enough for all those people. Make the people sit down, Jesus told them. There was a lot of grass there. So all the people sat down. They were about 5,000 men. Jesus took the bread, gave thanks to God, and distributed it to the people who were sitting there. He did the same with the fish, and they all had as much as they wanted. When they were full, he said to his disciples, Gather the pieces left over. Let us not waste any. So they gathered them up and filled 12 baskets with the pieces left over from the 5 barley loaves which the people had eaten. Seeing this miracle that Jesus had performed, the people there said, Surely this is a prophet who has come into the world. Jesus knew that they were about to come and seize him in order to make him king by force. So he went off again to the hills by himself. When evening came, Jesus' disciples went down to the lake, got into a boat, and went back across the lake towards Capernaum. Night came on, and Jesus had still not come to them. By then, a strong wind was blowing and stirring up the water. The disciples had rowed about 5 or 6 kilometres when they saw Jesus walking on the water, coming near the boat, and they were terrified. Don't be afraid, Jesus told them. It is I. Then they willingly took him into the boat, and immediately the boat reached land at the place where they were heading for. Amen. And thanks be to God, whose reading of his most holy word, and to his name be all praise and glory.
Thanks, Nora, for our 2 readings this morning. Of you like reading biographies? Hands up. Who likes reading biographies or autobiographies? Have you ever read more than 1 biography about the same person? If you have, then you'll know that they don't all contain exactly the same information. And one might look at just a small portion of a person's life, not their entire life. When it comes to reading the Gospels, they are no different. Because they are, in essence, biographies of Jesus' ministry, his 3 years of public ministry on earth. And just like multiple biographers write about the same person, in the Gospels, some information might appear on only one of them, or 2 or 3 of them, or so on. And if you were to read through all the Gospels and you were to make a list of all the events in Jesus' life, and in particular the miracles that he performed, then again, some will only appear in 1 Gospel, some appear in 2 or 3, but only 1 appears in all 4 Gospels. And that was the miracle that we just heard Nora reading out, the feeding of the 5,000. Now, the reason for this is each gospel writer, they were writing to a specific audience with a specific reason for writing the way they did. They weren't writing these letters to everyone. I'm sure they had absolutely no idea that not that long after they were written, they would be getting read by thousands, then millions of people right across the world. They wrote the way they did because they believed that's what their audience needed to hear at that time. And even though this miracle does appear in all 4 Gospels, it is interpreted and written differently in each of them. Last week, the 2 short passages that we heard from Mark's Gospel, I said that they bookended Mark's account of the feeding of the 5,000. But this morning we've heard John's account of the feeding of the 5,000. And if you were to read all 4 next to one another, yes, there are similarities, but there are also unique aspects to each story because of who each gospel writer was writing to. And if we take our reading this morning from John's Gospel, there are 2 distinct differences from the other Gospels, from the Synoptic Gospels. And the first one is in the other three, Matthew, Mark, and Luke. They all start off by mentioning how Jesus was compassionate for the people, and we looked at that a little bit last week. He had compassion on the hungry and shepherdless crowds. Whereas John doesn't mention that at all. John started his account of the feeding of the 5,000 by Jesus essentially teaching the disciples a lesson that they shouldn't underestimate his power. Now, I'm sure this doesn't mean that John thought Jesus was without compassion. Far from it. He just chose to focus on something else because of the audience he was writing to. So Jesus asks the disciples, how are we going to feed them? And as we heard Nora reading out, Jesus already knew the answer, but he wanted to test Philip. Philip assesses the situation, works out how many people there were, and ladies, again, I have a problem with this. It only mentions 5,000 men. It doesn't mention the women and the children. So they reckon there were probably near 10,000 people there. How are we going to feed them, Philip? And Philip comes up with the reasonable and logical answer. Well, we aren't, because we couldn't possibly afford to feed them. We don't have any money. Andrew then pipes up. Jesus, I found someone with food. But he's only got 5 loaves and 2 fish. That's not going to feed the thousands of people that are here. But interestingly, Jesus' reply is a compassionate reply. He doesn't rebuke them. He doesn't say something, oh, ye of little faith, as he does in other places. Instead, he just tells the disciples what to do. He asks them to get people to sit down in smaller groups, I mean, still in groups of 50. But Jesus takes charge of the situation. He gives thanks to God for what the little boy provided, blesses it, and then starts to distribute the food. He answered the two statements by the disciples that were perfectly logical and reasonable, and I'm sure some of us would have answered in similar ways given the situation. But he answers them with a miraculous demonstration of divine power that blows the realism that they were thinking, and maybe quite a few of the people that were there, maybe they were there thinking, how are we going to eat? How's this Jesus going to provide food for us? But he blows that realism out the water, and Jesus showed that when you trusted God, nothing was impossible. A reading from 2 Kings follows a similar path, that Elisha gets these 20 loaves of bread, and we're told it was 100 men, so again, we're maybe looking at over 200 people who were all there. But he trusts God, he thanks God, and they start to divide the food up. And similar to the feeding of the 5,000, there's food that's actually left over. The second main difference between John's account and the rest of the Gospels is that John tells us that this event takes place very close to the festival of Passover. He's the only one that does that. And it may seem quite like an insignificant detail, but it is actually at the heart of what the entire chapter, chapter 6, which is known as the Bread of Life chapter, claims about Jesus. Do you know that Jesus actually complained? We have him up there on this pedestal that he never did any wrong or whatever. But if you read the end of chapter 5, he's actually complaining that his opponents didn't believe what Moses had written. We're then ushered into the scene of the feeding of the 5,000 that takes place at Passover, one of the greatest events associated with Moses. But the text then overflows with echoes of the Passover event. For example, at the beginning of chapter 6, the events of the miraculous feeding, the salvation and rescue from the sea are joined together, just as the crossing of the sea and the food coming from heaven when the people were in the wilderness were joined together, part of the story of Moses. There is a testing between Jesus and the disciples, just as there was a testing in Exodus between God and his people. And Jesus commands that the pieces that are left over be all gathered up, that nothing is left, nothing is wasted, just as Moses did in the wilderness. And finally, the people grumble about their situation. We'll hear that later on in verse 41, because we're going to spend the next few weeks going through John's Gospel, chapter 6. And I'm sure you remember the whole of Israel were grumbling to God as he was leading them through the wilderness. So there are several distinct similarities between the Passover of Moses' time and the feeding of the 5,000 that John writes about. If chapter 5 ended with complaints about a shallow, superficial understanding of Moses, then chapter 6 shows a deeper, fuller understanding in the Passover that is now related to Jesus. And as we heard Nora read out in verse 14, maybe the people have started making those connections, because shortly after witnessing this miraculous event, they suddenly remember the promise of God that he would send a prophet like Moses. And they now declare that Jesus is this prophet. Jesus is the one sent to lead them. But they actually fail to realize what is actually happening, the sign that this is really revealing. Because instead of seeing Jesus as the embodiment of God's glory, his love and his word and his promises to the people, they see a king, a military figure, one that would serve their desires to get rid of the Romans. Passover is also a festival where there is a national liberation celebrated, that they would be freed from the foreign oppressor. They held Passover just before they left Egypt to go into the wilderness. But the people here now with Jesus, they find themselves under another foreign oppressor, the Romans. We maybe all remember the kind of jokey scene, you know, what have the Romans ever done for us? Well, I don't think the people back then would be quite as happy to have that question asked, because it wasn't a good time for them. There was a lot of oppression there. So maybe it wasn't surprising that they hoped Jesus was this future king, finally going to free them from Roman rule. But in doing that, they were looking for the wrong type of Jesus. So whilst the crowds were not only acting on their beliefs that they saw Jesus as somebody who he actually wasn't, they missed the point of what had just happened. They see what Jesus had did, they would have been amazed by what he did and the other miracles. But they wanted a glory for him that fitted into their assumptions and served their goals, i.e. their freedom from the Romans. They weren't looking at what his mission was. I wonder if that still goes on today in society. That there are times when people fail to see the depth of what God is doing because they're only focused on what serves their immediate needs. How can God serve them? How can God be useful to me? And when they do that, they actually miss everything God has for them, not only for their sake, but for the sake of the whole world. Back to our reading though this morning. The scene then shifts from one amazing miracle, the feeding of the 5,000, to another miracle, Jesus walking on the water. Again, there's echoes of Passover there. And it becomes clear that we're not just dealing with a miracle as if that wasn't enough, but it was the visible manifestation of God. And it terrifies the disciples. But Jesus reassures them as he walks over to them. He says, "Don't be afraid." He then further reassures them with the statement which, although translated in many Bible versions, "It is I," the root in the original Greek is "I am." The language of divine presence that God uses again when he meets with Moses at the burning bush. Jesus is letting his disciples know that they've just witnessed a very real and physical manifestation of God's presence among them. And both these miracles aren't just miracles. In John's vocabulary, they are signs, they're brief glimpses through a window of what was to come. The glory of God's presence throughout the entire world. That's what John was telling his audience. This is what's coming. So two amazing miracles, one after the other. Well, how do they relate to us this morning? Well, like the crowds in the passage who were fed to overflowing with bread and fish, we're continually fed. Not with bread and fish, not physically, but spiritually by God's grace, by his love, his mercy, all of which are never ending, all of which are limitless. But maybe there are times when we fail to see what God's doing among us. We're looking for the wrong kind of Jesus. And if that's the case, then we're only going to be disappointed. And I speak from personal experience. Because Jesus doesn't come to serve our needs, but rather to continue God's mission here on earth. Jesus came to us as God in the flesh, and he is the one that reveals the Father to everyone else. He said that no one can get to the Father unless they go through me. And Jesus wants to meet with people. He wants to meet with the fearful, the confident, the lonely, the gregarious, the weak, the strong. He meets us in threatening and safe times and places and says, "I am." He has come to be with each one of us and bring us that peace that only God can bring. This divine presence means that we who are called to be his followers, as his disciples, it's our job now to feed the hungry, to meet the needs of those around us, whatever that may be. And that falls into the five marks of mission. And I know I keep going on about the parish profile, but I want to share just what drew me to the church here. And one of the first things in the parish profile were the five marks of mission. It's wonderful to be part of a church where that is a focus, where that is a priority. We may find ourselves in a similar situation to the disciples in relation to the needs of those around us and the resources we have at our disposal. And it may seem that the resources that we have are not sufficient to meet the task in front of us. But what we need to remember is that God's resources never run out. They will never end. And they will provide us with everything that we need. There's a scripture that comes to my mind that I always go back to when I feel that we don't have enough to meet the needs of the people. And again, it's with Moses. And Moses is complaining to God, saying, "What do I do? I can't meet the needs of the people." And God just says to him, "What have you got in your hand? Use what you have. Don't worry about what you don't have." trust in me. Because all good gifts come from God. Jesus comes to open the hearts of everyone. And we can be a part of that. If we allow the I Am to open our eyes and our hearts to his presence in and through our lives. Amen. We will now uplift the offering for God's work, both here in the parish and globally. We sing our next hymn together this morning, Just As I Am. Let us come together in prayer. Let's pray. Loving God, we thank you that you are our creator and sustainer, that when you open your hand, you satisfy the hunger and thirst of every living being. And so we look to you whenever we are in need, trusting in your love and your abundant goodness. We've heard the miracle of how you once fed the hungry crowds with 5 loaves and 2 small fish. And just as that small boy gave what he had, we offer you our gifts, talents, and time, so that you may use what we offer to you for the work of your kingdom. We ask that you would again fill those who are empty this day. Pour out your Spirit on all who hunger and thirst. So this morning we pray for those who are physically hungry, those who don't know where their next meal is coming from. And we remember that those in this situation may live as far away as thousands of miles, or as close as only a few meters away from us. Lord, in your mercy, open your hand. Pour out your Spirit so that they may be filled. And may we, your church, meet these physical needs in whatever way we can. We pray for those who are emotionally empty, those who may live in busy streets yet feel lonely and isolated from their neighbours and long for friendship and just someone to talk to. For others who are caught in the grip of depression or anxiety, or trying to live with the trauma of grief, Lord, in your mercy, open your hand, pour out your Spirit so that they may be filled, and may we, your church, meet these emotional needs in whatever way we can. We pray for those who are spiritually empty, those who are troubled or have a sense of emptiness in their lives, those who long for purpose and meaning but don't know where to look, those who need you but do not yet know you. Lord, in your mercy, open your hand, pour out your Spirit so that they may be filled, and may we, your church, meet these spiritual needs in whatever way we can. Lord, we thank you for your abundant gifts in our lives. Pour out your Spirit on us and fill us with your compassion and love so that we would willingly share some of our abundance with those who have need. Loving God, we ask this prayer in your name and for your glory at this time. Amen. We close our service this morning by singing together, "We Sing a Love That Sets All People Free." As you go from this time of worship, remember God always keeps his promises. He is unfailingly gracious towards us. When we stumble, he is there to catch us. When we are weighed down by grief or trouble, he is there to strengthen and lift us up. So go from here in the knowledge that the love and mercy of God goes with you. And as you go, may the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be with you now and evermore.